My name is Gjermund Garaba. I'm from Norway. I'm a software engineer that works at ICF in the IBC team. So I work on the IBC Go protocol implementation, as well as now the Ethereum implementation, so the Solidity implementation of IBC Eureka. The goal, like I said, is to sort of change a bit about how one can think about IBC to come up with new ideas. It's something I've used a lot for like hackathons and like to come up with new interesting ways. And I'll go over a few different examples. And if you guys have examples of some of these or come up with some ideas, very, very cool if we can talk about it. But there's also this ideathon that's happening right now, the IBC ideathon. Is like, yeah, I guess the door hacks is Idea Hacker's Guide to IBC, which is not a hackathon, but an ideathon. So you don't need to be a developer to join. Just the goal is to get cool ideas of how IBC can be used, essentially. So that's fits very well into what I'm talking about here. So if you come up with ideas or want to join, it's a huge prize pool. You can first prizes also get to go to Istanbul and work with the team. And yeah, so definitely look that one up. So the way I see it, unlocking the potential of IBC is a lot about shifting their perspective. And that's what I mentioned earlier. A lot of people just think about it as a way to get tokens safely to and from different chains, which is a fair and very useful use case, but it can do a lot more. So the way that IBC high level works is that it's like you can think of it as a three-layer architecture, where at the bottom you have light clients, which are the ones that represent the counterparty chain. So like for chain A, the light client here is sort of representing chain B. So it's a light client of chain B, and chain B has a light client of chain A. So that's the sort of the verification layer or the state layer, depending on what you want to call it. And then you have IBC core, which is the core message processing. It's the one that takes in messages, talks to the light client, verifies that this message does in fact exist on the counterparty chain, and then it verifies that it's not timed out and all these kind of things. And finally, that packet is then sent to the IBC application itself. So IBC applications are the application-specific things. So that's the protocol itself doesn't care about the content of the packet, just like TCP/IP doesn't care about like the core content that's being sent. That's being handled by an application layer above. So it's just like TCP/IP verifies that it's in order and that it's all these things are correct. That's also what's happening here. So for instance, for token transfers, there is an IBC application called ICS20, which deals with token transfers. Yes, it's like just like TCP/IP is a message protocol. IBC is a message protocol, but built for a different type of environment. But it doesn't make sense for blockchains, because for blockchains, you need different kind of guarantees to know that the message actually has been sent and so on. So sort of you can sort of see the similarities in the stack itself. But what this actually means and why I think this is, at least for me, it's a useful analogy to think about sometimes, is that just like TCP/IP is sort of the backbone of most of the stuff that we do on the internet, the same can be true for IBC. You can do pretty much anything. It's not easy always to work on that level of abstraction, that low level, but this is how the internet was built out. You started out by getting these standardized protocols, and then you build stuff on top of it. The application layer for TCP/IP is HTTP, kind of a big deal. And then on top of HTTP, so it's a pretty useful layer to have there, and we kind of need it, I think, for blockchains to be very, very useful, unless you think there's going to be only one blockchain, which I think is a little crazy. I saw a tweet the other day where someone's like, it's sometimes useful to think about, if you think about blockchain as sort of like a server, If you replace server, blockchain with server, you only need one server. It doesn't make sense. It's not if we actually think that Web3 is going to be mainstream in any kind of useful way, it's just no way it's going to be one blockchain or just a couple. It's just not really scalable, I think. So just like with Web2, what sort of made that very, very useful and all the applications useful is that they were empowered to a large extent by APIs, by being able to connect to different servers, by being able to build on top of things that already exist. So a lot of the like early applications that are being built now, very few of them built really from scratch. They don't build databases from scratch. They don't build a lot of these things from scratch. And I think the important difference here, and why I think this is, why I in particular think IBC is so cool to work with, is because Web2 is very walled off. It's, you are at the mercy of whoever you want to build on top of, whoever you want to call to. Like the Twitter APIs being rugged, a bunch of people just lost the things they built. And in Web3, we can do better because there's so much of this is already, I mean, most blockchains are fairly open and you can pretty much connect to anything, which means that you can have your application and you can just connect to whatever, something cool that someone else has built on another chain. And this is sort of similar to what we saw, what was it, in 2001 or whatever, when like this DeFi Lego bricks was this meme that everyone was talking about. I think we can get there again, but not just DeFi necessarily, but sure, DeFi too. But just being able to connect all these different things that have been built already and are being built, and the things that you're building, having other people use that, is kind of a big deal. So that's sort of what's, and it's not just applications either, obviously. It's infrastructure that exists, you can connect to that, different protocols that you can build on top of this, and so on. So just to sort of give some like concrete use cases, I tried to kind of put them into different categories. Some of them overlap a bit, but things you can do is, so you have importing functionality, which like taking someone else's service, if you will, and using that instead of building it yourself, saving time and money and other things. External accounts, which I'll get a bit more into, but interchain accounts, if you've heard of it. Exporting functionality, so that's if you have something that you built and trying to make it easier for others to use. And then importing, exporting assets, which is tokens, which we already know, but it's a bit more than that too. And then protocols, which just new protocols that you can build on top of this, basically. And abstractions, so that's developer tooling, and then live clients, which is more technical. But yeah, so I guess I kind of covered this already, but it's basically this ability to pick and choose things that exist, connect them together, and then make something that's better, essentially. And coming more and more like specialized chains that deal with things that are not easy to get on. For instance, if you build on a general application chain, they might not have true randomness, for instance. But there are, or pseudo randomness. But anyway, the randomness is a difficult problem in blockchain because of you need things to be actually the same every time. But some have solved that, so you can connect out, get that from somewhere where you trust, and put it into your app. If you need some sort of privacy layer on top, you can do that. And this, like, if you think about the Celestia sort of vision of build whatever, connect to whatever, is also part of this. And external accounts is also, it's maybe one of the things that I've found the most fascinating to build funky things on top of. So interchain accounts is basically your application owns an account on a different chain. So there's no keys or anything. It's the security assumption is from the IBC itself. And you can have your application or your chain or whatever, control accounts on other chains. And what this means is you can do funny things like you can create an NFT that technically owns an account on another chain. And that account on another chain can own tokens or NFTs. It can be a validator, whatever. So basically, then you have an NFT that's wrapping all kinds of other assets on a different chain. So you can then you can trade this NFT or fractionalize it or whatever. You can share ownership. It opens up a lot of like funny things that you can do that are potentially useful and opens up new use cases. Yeah, exporting functionality. This is basically if you have something cool or something useful, trying to make it easier for others to use. So that's sort of like building an SDK or a little client library for someone to use. They don't have to connect manually. So that's in the more blockchain context, they've often been called outposts or proxies. So there's maybe like a smart contract that does all the IBC handling and stuff, but then other contracts on that chain can just call into that one and get access to it. So for instance, Jackal has outposts where people, so Jackal deals with decentralized storage, so you can handle storage things from other chains through their outposts. And Noise has the same, which is this randomness thing, so that you can have randomness more easily accessible. And then there's the one that we use mostly today, which is bringing assets in and out. I think Cosmoverse probably really pioneered and showcased how useful it is to be able to take popular assets into your chain and do stuff with them. But it's also other things like NFTs. So for instance, if you have a NFT marketplace like Stargaze and they want to maybe have other popular NFTs on their chain, they can actually transfer them over using IBC. And that's quite useful. And it's the same goes for, of course, transferring them out. So you have the Mad Scientist, which is the Osmosis one. You can transfer that over to Osmosis and you can do different things with them there. So a lot of different things you can do with that. And I think like assets is the one we know the best, but I think there's still a lot of useful things you can do there by using interchain accounts to wrap assets. What it also enables is that you can make an NFT out of an asset that's not inherently IBC transferable. So if you have some sort of weird, or let's not be weird, but something that's not like transferable over IBC, that it's not basically not a fungible token and not an NFT, which are many things like smart contracts, like you have different types of assets, like on region, for instance, they have these credits that they use, right? But they're not like it's its own type that's not inherently transferable unless you build a protocol for that specific asset. But that's not always really what you want. But what you can do here is you can make it into an NFT or an ERC-20 or whatever by sort of wrapping it with interchain accounts. And then there's protocols, which you can also build on top of this. Like I said, the IBC application on top is sort of the protocol, like the higher level protocol. So the token transfer is a protocol. ICS-721, which is NFT transfer, is a protocol. The interchain accounts thing I mentioned, that's also just a protocol that's built on top of this. And I think a cool example of that is something called Polytone, which is an interchain account-like protocol. So it is an interchain account protocol, but it's not like the same one because they wanted something else. They wanted something that could be deployed easily on Cosmos and that could be used sooner because they didn't want to wait for it to be available everywhere. So they built basically their own protocol on top of that. And then you have like automation things that you can put into this as well. So like the most like popular example today is probably packet forwarding, which is a middleware that allows you to take like when a packet is received, it can transfer it to another chain again, so you can have multiple hops, and you can put in automation such as when it reaches the final destination, it will do a swap and so on. So that's also different things that you can put into this. And then abstractions, which is just something I want more of. And I think there's a lot of things we can do to make IBC much easier to use, because it's not easy enough to use in many cases. So I want better like programming primitives, libraries that you can use to in different environments. There are like great frameworks that's are built on top of this, like Abstract. They have like a totally different notion of like how accounts abstraction work and how to deal with IBC and so on. But they built this to make it easier to work with. So things like that. And then orchestration, which I also think is very interesting. The code example here is from Agoric's orchestration framework, they have JavaScript, smart contracts, and you can do this these kind of things where you can connect to multiple chains and orchestrate larger flows of packets and actions, which is very useful. And these are the kind of things I want to get to this point basically with IBC, where whenever you want to do IBC stuff, you just list down the stuff you want to do, and then it's all atomic or rolls back and so on. So that's my dream for IBC to be that easy. Similar to how when you do HTTP stuff today, it's pretty damn easy. And then finally, light clients. So this is, again, like at the lowest level, and also something we need for expansion of IBC. So because you need a light client that works with the consensus algorithm of the counterparty chain. So for in Cosmos, that means Tendermint or Comet BFT light client that represents a Tendermint like Comet BFT chain. And for Ethereum, you need the Ethereum proof of stake consensus algorithm and so on. So there are multiple ones, and it becomes more interesting difficult when it's roll ups and layer twos and all this. Yeah. So basically what I was mentioning and why I think, I mean, I said this earlier, like why I think IBC is crucial, or we need interop basically for all of this stuff to be able to make any kind of sense in the long term. So because the number of chains are growing, and if the roll-up thesis is to really happen, as they say, it's going to be thousands and tens of, like, if they can't really talk to each other, it's kind of a waste, and it's not going to really work, I think. It's all going to be like tiny walled gardens that can't do anything. But that also means that there are a lot of opportunities to build these things, to build on top of it for all of these new chains. That means they can connect to everything else, which is also a huge opportunity for them, but also for the ones who want to build the enablers for this and so on. I mean, we see chains coming up now that the only thing they do is enable IBC for more things. So it's definitely a lot of things that can be done here. And yeah, like I said, this is where Web3 also has an opportunity, I think, to actually be better than Web2. Because I feel like the issue we've had with Web3 is that it's, for the most part, it's just worse. In terms of like user experience and what do you normal people perceive, it's just they go in and it's like, this is just utter and complete crap, and we can't have that. We have to have something that actually has better, can do more things and can be more interesting. Which is obviously not just the interoperability problem; it's a UX problem. It's a many problems, but interoperability is something that Web3 can actually do much better than Web2, because we don't have this all these walled gardens, because it's a different mechanism for how these different products and different things actually operate, and how they're meant to make money and so on, which sort of changes the dynamic, and I think that's important here. Yeah. So that's sort of the conclusion of this part. So I mean, just. I think we should stop to think about IBC as just a bridge and a token transfer thing, and more what would something look like if I could connect this and that together, similar to how a lot of Web2 innovations work. You don't really many of the Web2 innovations are just taking stuff that exists and just builds on top of it, make it work in a different way, put it in a different context, this kind of stuff. And we can do the same with Web3, I think. So, and I think IBC is really set to do that. So that's this part.
Can you talk more about the scalability of IBC? So does it require a light client on both chains to talk to each other? But what if you have thousands of chains, then it's an N squared problem.
Right, yeah. So the issue here is like how these talk to each other, because you need a light client on each of them. I mean, I don't necessarily see that as a problem, because like the light clients themselves, if it exists, like this type of light client. So for instance, for Cosmos, I mean, there's tenement one and everyone just uses the same one, and it's just configured differently. And it's not very different from, I don't think it really adds any overhead as long as there's not like N more consensus algorithms.
Okay, I thought it was for each chain, but it's really for each consensus algorithm.
Yeah, so it's okay. it's one implementation basically per type of consensus algorithm. I mean, some of them also probably will be relatively similar and have just small variations. These light clients are also like, you can set them up in a way that they're configurable. So for instance, they can be configured depending on how the other chain is set up essentially.
Okay.
So,
thank you.
Yeah. And I doubt we'll see that many new consensus algorithms, that this will be at least the main problem. So I mentioned it's, if you guys are interested in like going a bit into IBC Eureka, I have no real preparation for this. But I think it's still, useful to, I think I can show a bit about how it works and show some code if you're interested. Yes? IBC Eureka. The Solidity implementation and this repo as to sort of show how this works. I was sort of hoping there was a diagram here. There was not. Anyway, doesn't really matter. Let me go to this one because it actually has, I think it has the current diagram, which is probably helpful to show in terms of difference here. So like this is how IBC classic, if that's what we're gonna call it, the current IBC, how it's set up. So when you're going to make set up a connection between two chains, you need to do a couple of different things. So first you need to have a light client on each chain. So you create a light client on each chain that represents the other, and then you need to set up a connection. And this connection has there's like this handshake protocol that deals with versions and some other stuff. And then on top of that, you need to create a channel for each IBC application. So that's the port it's called, like the port. So the transfer is a port transfer. So that's a type of channel, and then you can create more channels and stuff. So there are three things to set it up, and it's quite heavy, a lot of heavy stuff to do this, and there's a lot of implementation to do this, like all this negotiation of handshakes, all these abstractions that you need to represent and deal with. I mean, we've done this in IBC Go. Obviously, but it's not a small code base to do something relatively simple. So what we've done in IBC Eureka is essentially we've taken connections and channels and just thrown them out because they're not strictly necessary. They hold a very small amount of information that is needed, but it's very little information compared to the cost of these abstractions. So instead, there is now essentially direct light client to light client connectivity. So when you first you set up the light clients, you just create them as usual, but then you just create one connection or channel, call it whatever you want, where all applications can work across. So it means that the setup is just for like one time for each chain pair you have. There's no, you don't need to set up new channels for new applications. You don't need to set up a new channel for all the things that are happening, which is also good for in terms of state bloat and other things. But it's also a lot simpler to implement. And when we first started to think about this, and we had sort of a rough idea what we thought this would look like. And the first thing we did was to make a proof of concept with in Cosmoverse. So we just implemented IBC Eureka, the current that version of it, and had a working IBC implementation in 2 weeks, which is very, very different than if it has all these things, because these things are hard to do and error prone, the all these handshakes and all the states. And it's also very important for environments where this is going to be implemented as smart contracts, because the smart contract implementation of this is a lot of smart contracts, because you need to deal with all these different things, the new smart contracts being per connection, per channel, so it's expensive, it's a lot of code, which is not great if you work with Solidity, and it's just complex and has shown to be too expensive for people to bother to do for the most part. Some have done it. It's definitely possible, but it's very, very, it's hard to really expand. And we want to get this into everywhere. I just need to get rid of the code here. Whatever, I'll fix that later. Let me just change to this one, which is where I wanted it. Is this size? I can change the to light theme if that's better. This one? Just make sure that everything is working. Okay, so this is the branch. It's all open source, and in the open, so you can go and check this code out whenever you want. Yeah, it's GitHub Cosmos Solidity IBC Eureka. The other one that I'll show is SP1 ICS. So this is the Solidity implementation of IBC Eureka, and it's basically three contracts at this point. It's a router contract that's sort of the core, IBC core, if you will, the one that takes in messages, handles the routing of them, and talks to the live clients, asks them if things are going okay. And it's a relatively simple, simple interface to work with here. So the most important things that they actually have to do is to be able to send packets, receive packets, acknowledge packets, and timeout packets. And that's sort of the core part of an IBC flow. Adding the IBC app, which is over there, is more like one-time things that you do if you have new applications to add. And yeah, it's not a very big interface you need to implement. And then the second one is the client part. So that's just sort of the handler for all the live clients that exist, and it's basically just storing live clients and routing to them and giving them identifiers and so on. So it's not a very very big contract either. Sort of just deals with the communication there, and then it's the IBC apps themselves, which just needs to know how to handle when there is a send packet, when there's a receive packet, when there's an acknowledgement packet, and when there's a timeout packet. So unless you're familiar, the acknowledge packet is like when you send a transfer, the first thing you do is you submit a packet that initiates the transfer on, let's say, chain A. Then that packet is being relayed over to chain B. And then when this has been processed, it sends an acknowledgement back so that it knows that this has been processed correctly. If that packet never actually arrives on the other chain, you want to make sure that it actually gets timed out so that you can get the funds back. So that's the timeout packet. And obviously the acknowledgement is there so that you can't time out something that's been actually processed. I just realized it's more there for scenarios where you need to do something specific after it's been processed on the other side, which is actually not that important for these transfers. Important for other things. So yeah, pretty small interfaces for the most part. Light clients, we haven't really changed those, so they deal with what they already do, which is updating their states, proving membership of packets and or state really, or lack of states, misbehavior and upgrades. Basically, when a packet is sent, someone submits a send packet. So this is a IBC protocol, like how this should look like. They just have this the port, and we still call it channel, but it's just it's actually the client on the other side that we're targeting, where it's coming from, where it's going to, and the data itself, which is the application specific data, and then when it's supposed to time out and potentially version. So the only thing that really happens here is that we find the counterparty client. So that just means that the connection has been set up. So there's a where I'm trying to send from and where I'm trying to send to is set up correctly. That like the timeout timestamp is in the future. We generate a sequence which is just we just have a counter for each client basically, and then we get our IBC app, and then we do the callback for the application to do its thing, and then we commit the packet. So the commit is just a hash of the packet itself. It's just a specific like format that's hashing different data in the packet. And the reason we do this is to be able to prove to the other chain that the packet has actually been sent. So when the other chain receives a packet, it needs to make it can't process it unless it's for sure knows that it actually exists. So the way that this is handled by traditional bridges is that you have a trust me bro set up with a multisig or something that attests to this. With IBC, we use light clients instead, which means that we can actually prove using like Merkle trees or whatever the setup is that this packet was actually in state of the other chain at the time that we care about. So that's that, and that is basically why IBC is so secure. It's because it has these light client proofs that are you can't really fake them unless the whole chain is able to fake things. And that's really all that happens in the send packet from a like core protocol thing. And this compared to the current version is quite simple. And it's basically the same things that are sort of happening for when you're receiving packets. You just this is just the opposite path, right? So you're just making sure that the packet you're getting exists on the other chain. So this is where we talk to our light client. Okay, does this thing exist? And so on. So that's pretty much the core protocol of it, which is honestly very simple and easy to implement. Like I said, the client thing is also it's not really interesting because it's just storing and keeping track of clients, right? And then it's application. So this just deals with escrowing tokens and making sure that everything is working okay there. And that's pretty much it. There are some details obviously on like the formatting and like that you need to make sure that you have the commitments correct and so on, but it's pretty simple. So that's pretty much how this works. And the last thing that I figured might be slightly interesting is our light client with Ethereum. So we're building this with the main goal of getting a direct connection with Ethereum without any third parties. So the first problem is that it's been complex, expensive to implement. But the other problem is that Light Client, or Tendermint in particular, and many others, honestly, but has been close to impossible, or at least infeasibly expensive, or just out of gas, impossible, to actually run the proofs, because you need to like do Merkle stuff, and it's strings, and that's a lot of crap that just makes it very... very hard to do. So for our Ethereum connection, we have built a live client that's using SP1. So SP1 is a CK VM that's made by Succinct, similar to Risk Zero's CK VM, if you heard about it. And basically what it allows is that, like compared to previous CK stuff where you had to hand write or hand roll, as it's often called, like CK circuits, zero knowledge circuits, it allows you to now just wrap Rust code. You just have your Rust code and you wrap it in a specific syntax or specific library, essentially, and then you have something that's CK provable. And what this allows for us is that we can take the expensive parts of verifying light clients on Ethereum, and we take code for that exists in Rust already, which is awesome for us. So we just had to take the code that already exists, wrap it in Rust, and write a little smart contract around it that just does some basic checking and things that are just not really, there are more like state changes because you can't, like CK is not state aware. And then you just verify the proof and that's it. Which means that this can be used by anyone. Get, you can verify a proof, you can just take this and use it. No, it's just decide to dive. I probably do, right? It's not there. So this is the CK program. I can fit on this screen basically. It just takes in some sort of input that we've defined that we need to have set up. Is it for membership? I guess it needs some sort of app hash, the key values it needs to prove, and then this is just handling the input basically, and then we just wrap it in Rust. So this is just Rust code, this membership. Okay, so I guess my Rust analyzer is gonna work forever now, so I'm not gonna get any help here. But it's just the Rust code that already exists that does tenement proofs. And this is cool because it allows us basically the entire execution of this light client is now running off chain, and you just do the proof on chain, which I think has a lot of interesting impacts for other things as well that we can run off chain. But yeah, so the actual light client for this, like for verify let's do update client because it's simple. So just to update a light client where you take, just need to make sure that the update to the current state of your light client, it just takes in this and runs the proof. It validates a couple of values and then it just checks the proof and then it can just update without having to do anything else because it can trust that that what has happened has happened exactly like he expected to. And this works because it's like each CK program has a unique value, and this is proving it against that it's actually this program that has been run with these exact values, with these exact outputs, and that will never change. So that allows us to do a lot of things with Ethereum that just was not really possible before. So we actually have, like, if you go and look at the repos for this, we have basically end-to-end full tests of Ethereum to Cosmos direct IBC connections. And essentially to connect to other chains, all we need are just to get some light clients for them. So the first thing, like when you create it the first time, it just takes that as initial state. That's sort of how the light clients work today as well. They don't really verify much on the initial state. It's just whenever you do a header update, so when you go from one like state of the light client to another, or add another state, it verifies that the change is correct. So it's in the case of Tendermint, it verifies that all the signatures from the validators are there, that the state change is valid, and so on. So it needs to run this do this update client. But actually, that's a great segue, because what this also allows us to do is to do multiple things at once in a single proof. So what we're also doing here is we have created another program that does update client plus verify membership. So it does all the verify stuff as well. So you can, which means that you can send a packet without doing the update first. You can do it at the same time. And since the CK proving itself, or the CK verifying itself, like the things that does need to happen on chain, it's verifying the proof. It is constant no matter what has gone on in the proof itself. So the proof can do arbitrarily complex computation, but the proof verification itself is always going to be the same. That's what's, it's like the succinctness property of ZK, which is what we're actually using here. Not this, the zero knowledge part is not so interesting here. So that's not really the point.
One of the use cases you talked about before in the earlier part of the talk was that, you know, IBC should just be a messaging protocol to do arbitrary things in other chains. So with this property, like let's say you had some action you did on you know, Cosmos chain that then you wanted to take some collateral outside of Cosmos, put it into a lending protocol on Ethereum, borrow against it, and then bring it back into a different chain in Cosmos, for example. Would you be able to verify that the smart contract executed appropriately with just this light client such that you can engage in all of those transactions and then have verification in those other chains that that happened to the to sort of the expectation that you had? Or is it just like header level, you know, state understanding?
It's not just header level.
Okay.
Yeah. The light client can prove arbitrary state on any chain, or any state, which means that, and this is a use case that we all actually thought about for in the context of Ethereum, because of the long wait for Ethereum to actually finalize properly. It's terrible UX to wait for 12 minutes or whatever. So what most bridges do today is that they have some sort of solver setup where the user locks their funds on one side, and then there's some sort of solver that just gives the user their own funds on the other side, and then calls back, and then they get the funds plus a little profit for like taking the risk. And you could basically do something similar with that. You can, as long as you can somehow represent what has happened on another chain, you can definitely do that. That is very likely to be part of the release here also, is there will be some sort of solver part that will just use the light client to prove this stuff.
Okay. So let's say this gets shipped to a mainnet or a production environment. And I understand that anyone can generate the ZK proof for the light client, but who is actually supposed to do it? And like, how expensive is it?
Yes, that's a very good question. And one that we haven't had to deal with in Cosmos with the tenement setup before, because for the most part, relaying is kind of inexpensive up until a point, of course, but then it's been sort of solved because there's the relative expenses is minimal. With Ethereum, just the gas cost alone makes this infeasible. So it means we need to find another solution for that. But yeah, to actually answer the first part of your question, which was who are actually supposed to run this, I think it will probably be some sort of relayer setup that needs to basically do what they do today, which is monitor the what's happening. And then they can just send out to a prover network, which exists, and they're efficient, and they have like GPU acceleration, and can do this very, very quickly. So they will sort of just send out that request and then submit that on-chain. But they do need to be paid for that somehow. So there's a couple of different ways this might play out. I expect that maybe some chains want to sort of have their own setup of this to be able to have reliable connections and like reasonable update times. Yeah, like a team might set up their own thing for that and pay it themselves or take some fee from somewhere else. I don't know. But yeah, this is something that needs to be handled and solved. And very much love to talk if people have ideas and stuff on that. Any other questions? Anything else you want to see or want me to talk about here? Or so if I'm familiar with Union, yes, I'm familiar with Union. Well, it's quite similar in some ways. They have their own sort of ZK thing. And it's also partially because they have a different... And they actually built a chain because of this. So they changed from Comet BFT to something called Comet BLS, which makes the signature verification cheaper. And also they have like a ZK, I'm pretty sure they have a ZK circuit that they built themselves that proves their own thing. So it's they have IBC that's doing something very similar. And we're actually for the for the Light client, the Ethereum Light client on, let's say, the Cosmos SDK chain. The one we're using now is the Union, the implementation that Union made for that, which is very good.